What did we learn here? Python is really flexible. You can do a lot of things in it. It's like that's actually like really cool as well, but like really dangerous at the same time. And that's actually what the two snakes in the logo represent. That Python is cool and Python is fairly cursed. I completely made that up. I have no idea what the snakes actually mean, but yeah, I like to think that. Yeah, hey everyone. So this talk was supposed to be titled What? It's based on this talk from 2012 with the same name, given by Gary Bernard. And like that talk, talks about JavaScript and Ruby, and how like certain things and certain behaviors in those talks just simply like does not make sense. Like they make you go like, what just happened? And I tried to do that for Python. But while I was writing down the talk, I found out that like it's not exactly possible for Python. Like the Python doesn't really have like such inconsistent behaviors for the most part. But while researching for the talk, I found a lot of peculiar things about Python. So I compiled them and that's the talk now. So the revised title was The What and the How. Like there's an alternative title called Is This Really Possible in Python? So that's what we'll be answering with the talk. So yeah, let's get started with this. The first what is trying to import a JSON file in Python. So this should not work. Python's import system is supposed to work with the Python files. So say you have a file called x.py, then you do import x, that like that Python file should get run. But so is it possible with Python that you try to import a JSON file, then it just works? Let's take a crack at that, shall we? So I have a few Python files here, and the first one is called python3-i 01json.py. So we have the JSON file right here called somefile.json that has data foobar. So if I were to do import somefile.json, surprisingly enough, somefile.json has been imported in Python. Now this should not work. Trying to import a JSON file with Python, this should not be possible. So how exactly is this working? Let's take a look at 01json.py. Now this works through the thing called the metapath with Python. And what we're doing is, we are doing sys.metapath.append JSON finder. And the basic idea behind this is that when Python tries to search for a file, it looks in sys.path, but sometimes the sys.path needs to be dynamic. So Python came up with a feature called sys.metapath, which contains a bunch of objects that get parsed the name of an import, and they let you know if that can be imported or not. So we have hacked that here to see if like the thing that we're trying to import ends with JSON, then we'll try to import it by just doing a JSON.load. So yeah. So surprisingly enough, you can simply try to import a JSON file and that will just work in Python. Like some file is a module and some file.json is JSON data. So yeah, the answer is yes, you can do that. And it just works with sys.metapath. It's a fairly unknown, not very useful feature of Python, but yeah, like that can be done. Why would you do this? I don't know, but yeah, you can do this. So the second one. So if you're familiar with the C or C++, you can pass things by reference and write functions like this, the swap function right here, which will swap the values in place and like when you try to print them, like So their actual values will be updated. But if you try to do that in Python, it doesn't really work. Say that we have a function that takes two arguments and we swap them around like this. Now, normally, if you have the two variables and you swap them like this, that should work. But if you pass them to the function, they shouldn't really get swapped here. So A is still 1, then B is still 2. But say that I were to try to import this file here. Let's run this live. So there is a function called swap. And say I redefine these variables with 3 and 5. Then I call swap A comma B. Then now suddenly the value of A is 5. Then the value of the B is 3. How can that possibly work? I thought that the Python was the pass by value language, and you can't really affect the variables that you passed from a different function. Well, the thing is, whatever you can think of, that's almost always possible with Python. And what we're doing here is we're using the thing called the stack frame. So if you ever use the debugger with Python, that lets you see through the stack frame, what the global variables are, what the local variables are, and so on. But the thing is, you can do the same thing with code, and you can actually modify these values from the code itself. So you can modify the global variables or the variables from an outside frame from an inner function. So that's what we're doing here. We're getting the parent frame, we're getting the locals, and we're actually parsing the bytecode to figure out which variable was passed here, because we get the values here, we don't get the variables here. They're going to have to show you this so it makes sense. Say that we have the function which does the exact same thing. Y equals 2, and then we call swap x comma y. Okay, so I'm going to disassemble this function to see what Python is actually doing when we try to run this function. So it tries to load these two variables, and then it loads the function swap from the global space. It loads the two names, then it calls the swap function with these two arguments. That's what this bytecode means. And the function waits on the call until the swap function has returned. So what we can do is we can figure out that, so this function has stopped right here, and just above it, the two variables are right there. So we are going to do exactly that. We are going to get the last four bytecodes to get the index A and the index B, and that will point to those two variables. So we can head to the local scope of this function to get those two variables names out, and then we can swap them in the locals. So that way we can actually do the sort of pass by reference in Python, even though it really should not be done. But yeah, so the answer is yeah, this works. And yeah, the technique is called the frame hacking. And so there was one thing that I did not go over right here. We have to do this small hack that goes into the C API of Python, and it makes sure that the bytecode that we changed actually gets changed. But yeah, the C API can be accessed from the built-in C types module, and it lets you do some really weird stuff, like resizing a tuple in place. And yeah, well, what's the point of all this? Why would you want to do frame hacking and so on? Well, there are actual software that you might have used that do the same thing. So the debuggers So I use the same idea of the getting the frames then accessing the values in them. If you have used IPython, that's like a better interactive console for Python that uses the same trick to get better autocomplete than the regular Python console. And so there's a built-in module called Inspect, which lets you do things like this. Zoom in on this. Yeah, so this is an interactive debugger which shows you the source code of the method that you're looking at. That shows you the function signature and the doc string and everything. And yeah, all of this is the possible because the Python basically lets you like hack through the stack frame at runtime. So yeah. Now what's here? Say that I'm a really weird person and I like single quotes, but I don't like double quotes. Is this possible to do with Python? And I think that at this point you kind of know the answer, but let's run this, 04quotes.py, let's run it in interactive mode. And yeah, so this is the regular Python interpreter. Import random dot rand int 3, 6. That gives you random values between 3 and 6. Yeah. Now, if I were to try to create a string with single quotes, that works. But if I try to use double quotes, nope, double quotes are not allowed. How could this possibly work? Well, the answer lies in this file. So, Python actually lets you create your own interactive consoles very easily. So it has a built-in module called the code, you can extend it yourself, and there's some boilerplate here. And you just have to call .interact on it, then it starts a REPL session. And now if I were to take out this code right here, then this will behave just like a regular Python interpreter. Like that's the amount of the code from line 22 down to 49. These about 15 lines of code is what you need to write your own Python REPL. But you can completely customize what actually happens when you press the enter key and Python tries to run the code. So you have the direct access to the source that gets run. And what I'm doing right here is I'm using the tokenize module to tokenize the source code to figure out if there are any strings in it. Then if they start with a double quote, then I raise a double quote error. And yeah, so the custom interpreters are actually quite powerful. So you can do a lot more than just stopping double quotes with them. So IPython itself, it's built with the similar custom interpreter. So there's a project that I wrote called ZXPy, which is quite cool. What it lets you do is that you can directly write shell commands in Python. And it also lets you capture the value. And now you have the value. And it also lets you do something really funky. It changes the behavior based on how many arguments we have on the left side of this string. So you can do the standard out, the standard error, and the return code. If you give it the 3 arguments on the left side of it, now it suddenly returns the 3 things, the standard out, the standard error, and the return code is 0. You could change the string to say, exit 5, and now the return code will be 5. So projects like these, and there's also a language called Highlang, that's like the Lisp syntax version of Python, where you're actually writing Python only, but the syntax looks like Lisp. Then it uses the similar custom interpreter to parse these brackets and convert it into regular Python code before running it. Okay, what's going on here? Have any of you heard of go-to statements? So they're a thing in C And what they let you do is they let you jump around to basically any part of the code. So this is an implementation of the built-in range function, where you give it a start and a stop, then it gives you the list. And we have implemented it with go to. Where we start with the start, then if it equals the stop value, it goes to the end of the function where we return. But if it doesn't, we append it, we do plus equal to 1, then we go back up here. So we keep looping until we get to stop, at which point we return. So is this possible in Python? This should not be possible, right? Like, why should we have good, like, how can we possibly have, well, yeah. Yeah, you can have go-to statements in Python, if you really want to, though. So here's this thing. So there's a library called the go-to-statement, which you can install. But, so it was broken since Python 3.8, so I had to patch it, so I'll have to pip install it from my own fork of it. But that should make this work. Let's run 05 goto.py. And now we have a function that was written with goto statements. And 3, 10, yeah. We have somehow created goto statements in Python. Of course, the syntax highlighting is not happy with this, but as long as the code runs, right? And there's something different with this piece of code than what I ran. There's a little decorator here, and we don't have it here. Can we actually make this work without a decorator? And the answer is yes, but sort of. So what we can do here is what a debugger does. So when you try to profile your program, so you try to trace your program, what happens is every single function call that you make, then every single line of code that that gets executed, that gets logged somewhere, right? That's the only way that you can track things like the coverage and so on. Well, Python lets you hack into that by this sys.setTrace function. And what we're doing here is if we find a function call, then it has the variable inside the function called goto, which we do right here, then we do this where we get the source code of the function itself and we wrap it with the add goto, and that's the original source code, and then we execute it. So this is basically the same as if that was on top of it, but we're doing it at runtime. So yeah, even that should work. And yeah, there you go. So we had my range 2, 5, and that works. So now it's not exactly the same. It does throw a name error right now, but I didn't have the time to fix that. But yeah, we can make it work. Okay, moving on. So classes.setTrace, by setting a tracer, you can actually track whatever is being executed and you can modify it at runtime. Why would you do that? Well, there's a few legitimate use cases, like calculating the code coverage or finding memory leaks in your code. But yeah, don't do this. Okay, this one is a bit more tricky. Say that we have the print statement, and it doesn't print what you want it to print. Can this be done? Well, it can be done fairly simply if you just redefine print. Say that we do this, import built-ins, and built-ins.print is actually where print resides. Built-ins.print, that's the original function. Say that we were to redefine print. It takes all the arguments and keyword arguments, and we do built-ins dot print. And it just ignores whatever you pass it. So okay, I made a typo. Let's do that again. Built-ins, B-U-I. Print, nope. Okay, so that's like fairly simple to do. The problem is, so this file, this does not contain any import built-ins or print equals to something. There's just a print hello world. And to make it a bit more convincing, I can do the pip freeze, which shows which packages are installed. Only the go-to statement package is installed, which also we can uninstall. Let's get rid of that. Wait, I was not supposed to do that. I have the separate environment already ready, which was completely clean. Pip freeze, there are no packages. There is a print hello world. How can it possibly be that when we run this with? That's not what it says right there. That says hello world. That says hello.meetup. How is this possible? Well, the truth lies with virtual environments. Let's actually head into this virtual environment. It's called env, and there are a few folders. So there's a lib Python 3.10 site packages. And if you look at this, this is exactly where the things that you install via pip get stored. And you can see that there are the few packages here. There's pip itself, there's a thing called package resources, there's the setup tools, and there's wheel. Now pip freeze is actually the program to exclude these four packages when you do pip freeze, because they come bundled with Python and with the virtual env program itself. So it gets rid of them because you didn't install them in the virtual env. But there's this one file here called AAA_hack.pth. What might that be? Okay, there's some code, and it's basically doing the same thing. It's doing import built-ins, and it's defining a new print function, and it's rewriting built-ins.print. So what's going on here? Well, the thing is, when Python starts up, it runs these .pth files. And it doesn't tell anyone that, hey, I'm going to run this file. It just does it. And it's kind of like, it's fairly weird. I'm not sure why they designed it this way. But so they're called path files. And they look for the most part like regular Python, but they are fairly restricted. And you're supposed to do things like modify the sys.metapath to make your library work. So when your library gets installed, you also ship these path files to do some setup so that your library can work. But yeah, we can basically write any Python code in there, and it might just work. They start with the interpreter, and they run some setup code, and they're fairly constrained actually. You can't write multiple lines of Python. Every single statement that you write has to be on one line, and the concept of the scoping is completely lost. So when you define a function, you can't access variables that's outside the function. That's the limitation with the .pth files. But that's definitely not good enough, because we can still do what I did here, which was I did an exec, which can run the completely arbitrary Python code. And we have new lines in here. And I basically ran this print hack.py. And you can see that I had to import built-ins. I had to use functools.partial, because if I try to do built-ins.print here, that actually won't work, because I can't access the something from inside a function that is defined outside the function. But yeah, so with some hacking, it's possible. But what does this mean? This means that we can, when Python starts, we can run whatever code we want. So as long as we can conform to these constraints. Okay, so I did a few things. I wrote the tweak. The first file that we saw with the loading JSON, I tweaked it a bit. I moved the imports inside. Then I defined with this class, inside that class, that you can do that. So the same with here. But now this code works inside a PTH file. And I wrote this wrapper called the PTHify, which just takes some source code. It wraps it with this exec call that we need to make it work with the PTH files, and it sets that .pth file that we saw just now. So what we can do now, let's actually go back to the old environment. So let's do this, and let's run this file with the tweaked json.py. Yeah, we have set the PTH, and now when Python starts, we don't need to do the import JSON thing anymore. That didn't actually work. One second. So yeah, my bad. Okay, so that actually worked. So now if I try to import some file .json, it just works. I don't need to have some library installed. Yeah, there's no libraries. I don't need to run some Python file. That's just regular old Python 3. And we can do JSON imports. And we can do a lot more. I could replace it with this tweaked quotes.py, which takes our code, which doesn't allow double quotes. And when I start Python 3, that looks like the regular interpreter, but it's not. When I try to do this, double quotes are not allowed. You can completely customize the behavior of your Python 3 executable by this one little hack. This is horrible. Never do this. Take in your company. I'm not responsible, but yeah. Why would you do this? I honestly don't know, but this has allowed a lot of hacks, like this library called the future fstrings, which lets you use fstrings in Python 2. So what it does is it takes the source code that is topped with this file, with this comment, and it defines the fstrings, then it converts the code to use string.format instead. So now suddenly you can start using the Python 3's features in Python 2. And there's also this, this is a very vast topic actually, the whole idea of using these PTH files and these coding comments. And so I did something with it. And I actually added the C style for loops with the start, the comma condition, comma step into Python. And there's an entire blog on how I did that. It's fairly complicated. I can't really go over this within the talk. Now, the question certainly arrives, can we do something nefarious with this? We can, when we type the Python 3, we expect to run our own code, not somebody else's code, right? But so this is doing exactly that. Can we do something nefarious? And yeah, let's take a look. So what are we doing here? So we have a function called password tracer, which opens a temporary file, and it finds if we are doing a function call, and if one of the arguments is called password, or if the function itself has the word password in it, it tracks what arguments were passed in, and it stores them in this temporary file. What could that do? Well, let's actually set this in the path. So .pth has been set. Now, when we start Python 3, that code should be running right now. The set trace has happened. So whatever we do now, that's being dragged. So now say that I have a function called set password, which has a P, and we do something with the argument, okay? And so we call set password with secret underscore 123, okay? Or say that we have a login function that takes a username and a password. Edge does something, and then we try to log in with user underscore 123, and the password is password 1234. Okay, now say that we're done with it. I try to cat slash temp slash trace log, and yeah, so we can see that we tried to call set password, and the first argument was p, and the value was the secret underscore 123. Now suddenly you can read passwords, and so we also called login. The username and password, they have been logged. And yeah, this can be running on your prod code base right now. But yeah, I'm not responsible for this. So well, what did we learn here? Python is really flexible. You can do a lot of things in it. Like that's actually like really cool as well, but like really dangerous at the same time. And that's actually what the two snakes in the logo represent, that Python is cool and Python is fairly cursed. I completely made that up. I have no idea what the snakes actually mean, but yeah, I like to think that. And so is this really possible in Python? Yeah. So that's about it. So follow me on Twitter. Yeah, bye.